up to this one, but I've never talked, so this is a new one. My background is cultural anthropology, so I'm working with qualitative methods. I do interviews with gamers. I do observant participant observations, and as you might have realized from my title, I'm concentrating on this topic of the so-called center of society. Let's see if this works. At the moment it doesn't. No? Anything changes now? Es leuchtet, aber es bewegt sich nichts. Bitte? Lösungsvorschläge? Impro. Ja, jetzt geht's. So, yeah, as you see, my topic is based on this notion of the center of society and about the things we hear pretty often in the last years, that gamers or gaming at some point have reached this center of society. So we're now there with all the other people who for some reason are allowed to be there. And if we look at this argument, even though people don't see a reason to explain what they exactly mean by the center of society, it seems pretty clear that it's about gaming having become something normal, something mainstream, and it doesn't really shock people anymore. And this notion is usually argued by two kinds of arguments. One of them, of course, is statistics like this one, published by the International Software Federation of Europe, that claims that 48% of Europeans are players nowadays, and even if in Austria the numbers are a little lower, it's 42%, but still we're closing in on being the majority. And the second kind of argument to support the trope of gamers at the center of society are singular events, like, for example, Angela Merkel, the German Chancellor, visiting the Gamescom this year, which is, of course, a representative of high politics coming to the biggest gaming event in Europe. And everybody knows wherever Angela Merkel goes, she takes the center of society with her. So. These cosplayers are really close to the center of society at this point. So this is what we have in mind, and there is one question that might follow up to that, and that is, why is it even important for us gamers to see this movement towards the center of society? And to get a little bit behind that, I just want to take a quick look at the history of gaming, just very quickly, since its beginnings in the 1970s and 80s as a medium of mass entertainment, gaming has gone through many different phases of perception, but it has very often been linked to things like violence and juvenile misconduct and whatever, and so on and so forth, violence always being the most prominent amongst these. And especially in Germany and Austria, and that relation is pretty closely linked to Germany. In the 2000s, we had this so-called Killerspieldebatte that was started by a school shooting in Erfurt and led to stricter rules, stricter laws about games and gaming, and a big debate in the media, of course. So, seeing this background, it's of course no wonder that we as a gaming community are pretty happy to see things like this, which was the Austrian Play Fair, Play Austria, just a few weeks ago, that was prominently covered on the landing page of the ORF.at, which is the big public news agency in Austria. So, we see the change, and that, of course, adds up to this picture of us or of gaming having reached the center of society. So these developments are accompanied by a continuous approximation of the average gamer to the average citizen we see in the statistics, because I would argue that at the moment the average player is still a male. He is getting older and more feminine every year. So if we see this, it's pretty clear that the notion of gaming at the center of society is not just understandable, but it's in a way even pretty precise in describing statistically measurable developments. But as you might have realized reading my title, I'm here to challenge this notion, and I do that, basically concentrating on qualitative research. But I'll just take a very quick look at statistics once more. Seeing statistics, it's very important to see that most of the big statistics we have are somehow are made on behalf of the software industry, like the one I showed you from the ESFE, or also big studies we have from the Entertainment Software Association. And in the study I showed you before, everybody is considered to be a gamer who has played a game on any of the devices and formats listed below in the past 12 months. So everybody who played a game throughout the last 12 months is considered a gamer. And of course, through these kinds of questions, these big numbers are generated, but it's not so sure if that meets the perception of society, what we would call gamers, usually somehow being linked to people frequently spending quite a good amount of their free time playing these games. But there's a lot to say about these statistics. Of course, they're not incorrect. It's just the way they ask questions and the way they generate numbers and present them that might influence the public perception a little bit. But things get, of course, a little more complex when we look at the players themselves and at the question if they themselves see themselves as gamers. And here I want to introduce to you a guy called Erich. He was interviewed by me, and just a short time before we had our interview, he had downgraded his four-screen PC desk to two screens. Up to that time, he had been playing EVE Online pretty excessively, and when he stopped that, he said, well, two screens is enough. And when I asked him if he felt, if he was a gamer, he said, well, no, I'm not a Zocker, which is the German term, I'm not a gamer, it's just part of my everyday life. So he didn't want to be called a gamer. A second example would be Walter, who was a technician, 36 years old, and he had Nintendo characters tattooed on his leg, and he also said, no, he's not a gamer, you're just a gamer if you play more or less professionally. And these are just two examples out of a big number of people who are pretty hesitant about identifying with this term of being a gamer, being a Zocker, or even considering this as a major hobby of them. And these findings do correspond with other qualitative research that concentrates on gamer identity. So to give an example, in her article, Do You Identify as a Gamer? Gender, Race, Sexuality, and Gamer Identity, Adrienne Shaw states that people who play digital games tend to be very hesitant to consider themselves as gamers, and this dynamic seems to be especially strong among women. That's an experience I also made when I asked women to talk to me about their gaming habits for my studies. They often questioned the fact that they were even relevant for me because they were not much of a gamer, as they said. Even though they played pretty complex games like Civilizations and Skyrim and World of Warcraft, so they spend a lot of time with these games. And Simeon Yates and Karen Littleton found that even children talk about the downsides of being considered a gamer because they linked the term to being geeky or being an outsider. So when I asked interviewers directly if they talk about their gaming habits outside of their gamers' communities, they usually give me a quick yes, and that's shortly followed by something like, well, maybe not at the first date. Because at the first date, you want to give a good picture of yourself, and it might be dangerous to talk about the computer games or the games you just play, so you hide your gamer's identity when you're at the date. Other examples they gave me were, for example, job interviews. They said, well, if we talk about hobbies at a job interview, I won't talk about gaming. And when we were elaborating more on the topic, Peter, a young man who was just finishing his training as a professional pilot at the time, he told me that he talks about games predominantly in his specific gamer settings. So for example, when his friends come over to play Battlefield at his flat. But he said at more diverse social locations like parties, it's not such a good idea to talk a lot about games. And he said that's because you would exclude others from the conversation. And just a moment later, he said, well, actually, it's the other way around. He experienced that if you talk about games at a party, you might exclude yourself from the rest of the party, and that's, of course, a thing you don't want to do. Another example would be Brigitte, university student and World of Warcraft player, and she said that people outside of gaming communities have almost no concept of what World of Warcraft really is. So when she talks about it, she sticks to pretty basic descriptions, never mentioning how much time she plays or how it really works. So summing these examples up, it seems that many gamers do not feel comfortable about being very open about their gaming habits. On the one hand, they tend not to identify with terms like gamer or zocker or whatever. And on the other hand, when talking to people they perceive as non-gamers, they hold back their enthusiasm for the games, especially in situations in which they want to convince somebody about their personal qualities like dates or job interviews and so on. And this might, of course, also be seen as one part of the answer to the question why gaming is still perceived as such a juvenile or childish hobby, because grown-ups tend not to talk about their gaming outside of the specific communities. So, why the velvet gloves? Why is it so important for gamers to be careful about whom to talk to when they talk about gaming? Thinking about these explanations, we always come back to stereotypes. Just like the children studied by Yates and Littleton, adult players do not want to be related to stereotypes of the geek, of the antisocial loner, or the nerd. And this again means that opposing to the notion of gaming having become something perfectly normal, the established stereotypes about games have not yet been overcome. They still have remarkable impact on gamers' behavior, confronting them with the perceived need to justify what they're doing. Because even if I didn't ask them in interviews, most of the gamers at some point told me about their social attitude. They said, well, you know, whenever I get to choose between a social possibility and a gaming opportunity, I always choose the social one. So even though I didn't even ask that, they want to make sure that I don't perceive them as outsiders or loners. In some interviews, players also emphasized their pacifistic ideals, saying, well, my interest in weapons and violence is only restricted to the gaming. So this just shows how powerful these stereotypes still are. And to understand the stereotypes a little better, it might be a good idea to look at theories of this guy. He's called Howard Becker. Some of you might know him. He's a US sociologist and also a jazz pianist, who contributed to a theory that became known as the labeling theory, that concentrates on deviant behavior. And to sum it up really quickly, his main points could be summed up as, first, deviant behavior is not an objective fact. This might be clear for most of us, but is not always clear in all parts of this discussion. You cannot objectively tell what is normal and what is not normal, but it's the construction of it's constructed through social power relations. So those within a society who are powerful get to choose what is normal and what is abnormal, and if you don't fit into their norms, then you're considered to be deviant. And the third point that is really important for the rest of my talk is that the definition of what is normal consolidates social structures. So the group has the same idea of what is normal, and that's what keeps the group together. So when gamers accuse their critics of not understanding the meta and denying their competence to judge it, while at the same time somehow accepting those critics' judgment by defending oneself against them, fits very well into Howard S. Becker's theories, because according to Becker, people who have been labeled as deviant often argue that those who label them are the abnormal. They challenge their power to set the rules. We know that from a gamer's perspective, that we say, well, those people who criticize the games, they don't have any clue about the game, so they're not allowed to have that opinion. But at the same time, they claim not to be deviant, referring to the terms of those who set up the rules and accepting them somehow on the go. So in this regard, it appears to be very fruitful to look at gaming against the background of theories of stigma and deviant behavior. When I interviewed teachers and parents about their views of video games, I experienced that most of the perceived juvenile misconduct was set into some form of relation to media usage, especially game usage. So different forms of aggression, as well as lacking concentration in class or lacking interest in the world around them or politics, they were all somehow explained by the video games they played, only marginally taking into consideration that there might be other good reasons for the children to act that way. And these arguments strongly remind of Jürgen Hohmeier's description of stigmatization, who says that, which is closely related to Becker's theories, and it claims that all behavior of the stigmatized is always set into relation to the stigma. So everything a gamer does wrong is somehow set into relation to the gaming and not to other parts of his or her free time activities or lives. And as another basic characteristic of stigma, Hohmeier describes the tendency to relate the negative attributes of the stigmatized group to some warring influences on society. So to give an example, when Catherine, a teacher in her 40s, she told me about children in her school that she perceived as having no social boundaries and no feeling for social boundaries, she explained this observation by referring to the empowerment that those children felt in the games. And then she quickly connected this to school shootings in the US, because she said, well, they lose all feelings for social boundaries, and that's what drives people to do such things, because, as she said, it is well known that the attackers in these school shootings were highly addicted to games and all these kind of argumentations we know. So what she does is she links her students, who she perceives as gamers, to the stereotypes she has, and then she links those stereotypes to to things she experiences through the media and that worry her about the development of society. So while parents and teachers tend to talk about digital gaming as a youth phenomenon, my interviews with adult players show that stigmatization does not stop with maturity. So Brigitte, the World of Warcraft player we talked about earlier, she mentioned the surprise she experienced when she told people that a part of playing World of Warcraft, she's pretty active in her sports club. And she says people just don't believe that. And two young men told me that it's easier for them to talk about their gaming life outside of their gaming communities as long as they are in relationships. Because they said whenever you're single and you tell somebody that you play games, they say, well, that's why you're single. So coming back to this center of society trope, there is one point that the commentators who use it seem to overlook. Since science as well as the mere statistics seem to prove the point that there is a strong move towards the center. But, and we're going to experience that painfully on Sunday, I think, in Austria after the elections, public opinion is not always based on what we would call facts. So yes, the majority of players might be grown-ups by now, but that doesn't change the picture of that being a juvenile and childish experience. And yes, there are studies that show that World of Warcraft players may be fitter and higher educated than the average citizen, but it's just one report of a Chinese falling off his chair after an excessively long play session of World of Warcraft has more impact on the public picture of the game than all those sober numbers. And the reason is because people just want to believe in the stereotypical picture and they want to keep it up. And that seems to be the obvious explanation for this form of opinion making, and it leads to the last and most important question of this talk: why are gamer stereotypes so persistent? Before presenting this last part, I just want to say this is still work in progress, so even though I'm sure that I'm following an important track here, there's still research to be done to get a clearer picture of it. But reflecting on stigma and deviant behavior means reflecting on social power structures. And stereotypes and the way we see and interpret the world around us stand in strong relation to the question whom we experience to be competent to interpret the world for us. And a lot seems to have changed in this respect throughout the last years. Science and academia, as well as parts of the informational media, have lost parts of their power, weakening their status as some of the highest authorities when it comes to interpreting the world. So when Kaspar Maase has shown in his work on youth and mass media, when judging the behavior of younger generations, people have always liked to rely on what they call common sense, even challenging scientific data if necessary. So for, to give an, one more example, Christian, a teacher and a father of two children, he referred to scientific results that said that there is no direct link between violence in games and violent behavior of young people. But he only did that to say, well, I cannot comprehend that kind of nonsense just using my common sense here. So his common sense overruled his knowledge about science because he just wanted to stick to his picture of the world. And to get a better understanding of what's happening here and why this common sense is so strong, let's take a look at the theories of this guy. He's called Pierre Bourdieu, and for people who come from my academic background, he might be considered as one of the most influential thinkers of the last century. And he came up with a very precise theory of the habitus. And I'm going to sum that big theory up in two pictures, which he probably won't like. But he says that he describes the habitus as a set of individual tools to interpret the world and to interact with the world, which every human being takes on according to his social background and collected experience. The habitus defines how we see the world, what we consider to be relevant, and how we react to our surrounding. And of course, it's adjusted to the parameters of the social group we come from. So if I'm from the hammer group, then I've got a hammer habitus, and I know how to deal with hammer situations. Again, I don't think Bourdieu will like this. But so that the important thing is that as long as I'm moving around in worlds that are familiar to my social group, I know how to deal with it. But as soon as I experience challenges that don't fit to my habitus, irritation comes up. I don't know how to deal with that. I have to adapt my habitus. And since the habitus is passed on from the older generations to the younger ones, it's always shaped by experiences made in the past. Hence, we are always in need to adapt to new circumstances. And this necessity of the younger generations to slowly but continuously challenge the habitus provided by their social background leads to their intergenerational conflicts. And now that's the important point, these conflicts are dealt with on a highly moral level because the collective habitus, as we've seen with Becker, is what keeps the social group together. So the fact that everybody more or less perceives the world in the same way is what makes a social group a social group. And this fundamental significance of the habitus for the existence of the social group explains the strong urge to avert any form of change rather than to adapt to it. So to give a quick example, if a daughter spends an enormous amount of time playing video games her parents don't understand, then for her, the adapting to this new world she wasn't prepared for might bring enough joy and enough social capital to motivate her to do it. But for her parents, it's hard to understand that, and it's threatening to weaken the status of their social group. So they will be willing to spend a significant amount of energy in preventing that change. Following Bourdieu's theory, when choosing information, the preserving tendencies of the habitus, let us choose the information that confirms what we already want to know. And that's what we've seen with the teacher who just put his common sense above the scientific results. So to give an example, if Manfred Spitzer argues that digital games damage our brains and make us more aggressive, as he does in his best-selling book, Digitale Demenz, Digital Dementia, all the critique of his methods and his sources and his arguments will not change the minds of the people who just want to believe him, because the new media threaten their understanding of the world and thus the cohesion of their social group. So their habitus will find a way to skip that information and stick with the worldview you they want to stick with. So even if the criticism of gaming, the criticism gaming has been facing throughout the last decades is in many ways directly comparable to criticism of other media of entertainment like comic books and action movies, we all know that, no media has withdrawn itself so far from the interpretational power of those who set up the rules. And this, of course, challenges social norms and power structures. So the people outside of gaming communities don't just lack the tools to interpret the games, but they often even lack the tools to access these games. And that makes this power struggle even stronger. Because where Bourdieu and Becker come together is that they say change challenges social structures, and those in power will always struggle to defend these structures. And this struggle will influence whom they believe, which information they will take into account, and what they will try to understand. By not showing interest in digital games, as we still see it in the media, these games are not getting broader attention, and that is going to slow down the development of the public perception of the games. So the fact that every article and feature about games and gaming culture outside of the specific media is followed by cheer of the community just shows that this is still far from being normal. And there are strong forces at work that want to keep it that way, just because new forms of media bring change and they want to avert the change. As long as these games feel strange and somewhat threatening to large parts of our society, they can be held responsible for any form of juvenile misconduct, even if the players are not young people anymore. So this helps to keep up the perception of young men and young people being somehow dangerous for society, which then again justifies attempts to force them to fit into our norms. So at the same time, it leaves the blame to the games, and the existing social structures don't have the need to dig into their own structures to find reasons for this misconduct. So what both the habitus and the stigma and deviant behavior theories point out is, however, that it's not a them against us situation. We're all participating in the same game here. So as long as stereotypes are strong, gamers are motivated to hide their gaming identity, forming subcultural tendencies, defending themselves against any form of criticism, as we have seen with Gamergate, for example, where they defend themselves against it with all of their powers, passing borders that we thought would have been there. And of course, that makes it increasingly hard for people outside of gamers community to understand what is happening there, which again will strengthen stereotypes and might even motivate them to develop measures to work against it. So this is the final picture, and I hope it explains a little bit why it's so hard to change these stereotypes, because as we experience in other parts of our lives, it's often not enough to give facts, but it's more about taking the fears of the change of societies, which is a very hard thing to do. And if you would want to argue that this is going to change now because people who grew up with games are now getting parents and they are reaching higher and higher positions within society, then I would just advise you go ask any passionate gamer in his 30s about the Overwatch community or PewDiePie, and you will find out that it's the same wheel starting once over again, because of course what we played when we were young, that were really good games and everybody was enjoying things together, but those stupid things kids nowadays do on their mobile phones, that's just not the same thing. So, thank you very much.